also many other things. So I need to work through those emotions. But if we do those three things and we operate upon our soul condition, then everything will work in a manner that is in harmony with our soul condition getting closer to God. So hopefully from this discussion now, everyone understands how you can use the law of attraction. Is everyone fine with that? So what we'll do after this, we'll have a break for half an hour or so, and then what we'll do is we'll discuss, have personal discussions. You can raise personal issues and questions in your own life about your own law of attraction issues, and we can talk about what's actually happening. And some of you may like to come and sit up with me in a hot seat or maybe and explain some of your law of attraction events and how you might have questions about them or something like that, and we can talk about them more thoroughly. Does that sound all right?
Yes.
Good day. Thanks for your time. So now I'm all energized. And some of you here today, some of you here today have probably not had a CD that contains all of the pageant messages and quite a lot of natural love spirit messages as well on the CD. So if you're one of those people that haven't got it, that we've just made up another 100 CDs or so and are available, is just out the back here, is it? Yeah, so they're just out the back. So you can pick them up, they're free, so you can pick them up. They contain probably close to 5,000 spirit messages or so on there. So it's quite a lot. Alright. One other thing I'd like to say too is a lot of people have been asking me for private lessons, if they could call it that. And I'm avoiding doing that at this point. And the reason why... Sorry. The reason why is that I'm still really focused on dealing with my own emotional condition and spending time with Mary, of course, as well, which has been really lovely. And so that's really going to continue to be my focus. So I'll only be doing the public sessions. But there are two people who I feel are ready to help others emotionally. They're in a state where they are fully respective of their own law of attraction and are really, really good in terms of connecting with their own emotions. And they have a strong connection with God as well. And so I'd like to introduce them to you. They both, one of them is aware. One of them is Tristan, my son. So Tris, could you just come up here for a moment? This is Tristan. And most of you by now realise that when it comes to impartiality, I'm pretty impartial with everyone, including my children. So what I'm about to say about my son has nothing to do with him being my son, actually. It's got everything to do with the fact of what he's been doing and how he's been working through his stuff. And if he wasn't in the condition he is, I wouldn't be saying these things about it. But Tristan's been working through his emotions now for probably the last 18 months, pretty solidly. He actually finished up putting some of his emotional conditions on the YouTube, for those of you who want to. I can't remember the sign on or anything like that, but what is it?
Just go YouTube /EnforcerPure. It's
Enforcer Pure.
Yeah.
ENFORCER. Enforcer Pure.
Yeah. And it's just me after a cry or after some big resistance and I'm asthmatic and I'm scared and whatever, and just me talking about that. And there's also me trying to talk about emotional processing as well. It's just me trying to say what I'm doing, even though it's, to me at the time, it wasn't amazing.
So Tris is in a very humble state. He has to be living with me. He has lived with me for 18 months. And a lot of you wouldn't realise that he's actually got the ability to help many of you who are much, much older than he is. And so one of the things you'll learn on this path is that a child can teach you, so therefore a teenager or a young adult can certainly teach you, and particularly if that person's in a good emotional space, which Tristan's in. So Tristan, obviously, doing these things is, again, the people who I'm going to introduce to you are doing all of their things by donation. So they're doing the same thing as what I'm doing, and that is giving their time by donation. And so Tristan would be doing that as well. Obviously, Tristan has to live too, and he's currently working through those emotional issues.
As most of you already know when you talk to him.
He moved out about 3 weeks ago, or 4 weeks ago, so he's working his way through all of that. And one thing that Tristan is very, very good at is looking at law of attraction and how it's affecting him. And he's very good at that with his own life, and he's very good with that with helping you as well. He's also very sensitive emotionally and has quite a lot of intuition from spirits as well. So those things can certainly find very helpful. But his focus will not be on your intellect. So if you're one of the persons who wants some assistance, personal assistance, Tristan will be willing to help. So that's Tristan. Contact details for Tristan.
Should I write them up?
You want to just write them on the board?
I'll write them this morning. Forgive the email address. It was started when I was in high school, and it's a little bit weird.
It started when he was in a rage. And the next person I'd like to introduce you to is Millie. So Millie, would you like to... Now Millie's, I met Millie 2 years ago now, and Millie's always had a really, really strong spirit connection, and she's an artist as well. And the way I met her was that I sat down with her, I was invited to a spiritualist church, what would you call it, a fete or something like that, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And Millie was there drawing pictures of people's emotional condition, which interested me quite a lot. The lady who was before me, she sat down and drew the emotional condition of this woman. And when I saw the picture, because the woman sat down next to me, it was a direct reflection of what I could feel from the woman, and Millie had actually drawn it. And so the woman looked one way, but the picture looked a totally different way. And it reflected to the woman her own emotional condition. And one of the things the woman said was, "Wow, that's exactly what I feel." So it was very powerful. So that's how I met Millie. So she drew me a picture and got a bit freaked out about the message that she put on the picture. And that's how our relationship started. And Millie at one point was had a spiritualist church that she looked after up Gympie Way, and which she's stopped doing now. But one of Millie's passions is to start helping people actually access their emotions, and in particular access their anger emotions and step underneath their anger emotions. And what she's doing is she's setting up, she's got a place up near Gympie, where people after March, so in April and after, will be able to come up and stay with her for a few days and get triggered. And so if that appeals to you. Again, Millie is willing to do that by donation, so it all depends on donations in terms of what she's doing. And of course it will depend on her time as well. Again, Millie's in a very similar state that I've mentioned Tristan was in, very humble state, very open to dealing with emotions. Millie has lots of spirit intuition and receives very direct messages from spirits as well. And she's actually channeled me to myself in my sleep state quite often. Which has been very helpful for me. And she channeled Mary to Mary in her sleep state as well. So it's all, it's all been really, really helpful from an emotional perspective. So remember again, Millie's focus would be your emotions. So if you go up there in a very intellectual space and expecting to stay in that space, then I'm pretty sure she'll send you home quite early in the visit. So, it's lovely that I can now that I can introduce her to you. She's looking radiant.
Thank you.
And your contact details?
Yeah,
like
I'll write them up there.
Write them there.
Tristan, your email address, is that a dot, an underscore, or a dash?
A dot.
Yeah.
Now, as time progresses, many of you will get into a similar space. And as that occurs, obviously there'll become a time when I won't be able to have all of you up here saying what you're doing. But I wanted to do that at this moment because I know quite a lot of you are feeling like you need some kind of personal help.
Yes.
And while I'm not doing that at the moment, I'm doing that more still in groups. And I am helping people personally, but it's usually because I've visited them and stayed with them or whatever, but not doing it on a consistent basis, and nor am I wanting to at this point. I thought I'd just introduce you to a couple who I feel are ready emotionally to be in that space, who are in a really humble space, who can help you deal with your stuff if you want to. Now, obviously, as time progresses, some of you will be in that same space, and we'll try and introduce you as well to others. And once that all occurs, I'm sure after a while there'll be so many of you in that space that it will be well known that the help and assistance you can give to others. By the way, both Millie and Tristan obviously are not perfect. And obviously, just like myself, they have emotions to work through, Cyril. So, if you expect perfection out of this, then you need to be going somewhere else, obviously. So just bear that in mind if you do visit them or see them. But they are in a very humble space, and it's a very different space than if you visit a psychic or a medium or anyone else who's going to be helping you more on a non-charge basis. They're in a very different space to that. So they're in a very good divine love space, and that's why I've recommended them to you. All right, now's the time for our personal questions and chats.
Up there?
Oh, you put up your hand, right? You didn't know I was going to be up here.
No, I didn't.
But you did.
Okay, I'll come up there. Hi.
And this is Ray, by the way.
Hi.
Hello, everyone.
Hello, everyone. When we first started today, not only myself, but quite a few different people got really, really sleepy,
mm-hmm.
and were getting pulled out of our bodies and nodding, and I must have yawned 50 times.
Yep.
And I would like to know what was happening, other than, resistance or whatever.
Other than resistance.
But why?
So you don't really want to know what's happening?
Yeah, I do. I do. I really, really do.
No worries. What was happening was resistance.
Okay.
What's happening is that when we are in a state emotionally where we want to resist certain information, because at the soul level we feel we're not ready to actually deal with it. Of course we are ready. If we're hearing the information, we're already ready.
Yeah.
But because there's the resistance emotionally, what's actually happening inside of us is we go into these states, and spirits who will be in the same state will connect with us, and they'll also help us to go into the same state. And this is why sometimes you go into out-of-body, or you feel tired, or almost sleepy, or you're not off, and all those kind of things. If there's subjects that you're not off with, they are definite law of attraction things you need to look at seriously.
Okay.
So there is a strong resistance in you to look at your own law of attraction and deal with that emotionally.
Okay.
So the key for you now is to say, all right, that's the truth. It doesn't mean you have to change it, but that is the truth. At least let yourself feel that truth.
Yes. I'm very aware of that.
Yeah.
And also I wanted to tell you that I found a great tool, because I went to a movie, which I emailed you about. It triggered me like crazy. I had to leave in the middle of the movie. It was so intense.
Yeah.
The next morning
what
I woke up.
What movie was that
about? It was Slumdog Millionaire.
Oh, okay.
And it's actually real. It's about the children in the slums in Mumbai.
Yeah.
And if they were victims, they were abandoned. It's like all my issues, right,
yeah.
were
yeah.
in the movie.
Yeah.
And it was so intense, and the sound was so loud, and I just had to leave the theater.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so for a couple of days, the rage is coming up, and we've gotten a big process, a lot of things happen.
Mm-hmm.
I was cooking, I didn't want to be cooking, and I'm hammering the spoon on the pan, and I'm brutalizing on the meal.
Yeah.
And I didn't have
cooking
any,
with a lot of blood.
Not a lot of blood. And it tasted awful, my man. But what happened was, I realized that I could feel it. It was like right there, and I didn't know what to do with it. So the next morning, I woke up, and the message was that I needed to go get a tennis racket. So I went to an op shop, and I found a squash racket. And I've got that puppy sitting right there because I am ready now. And I knew at that moment it could have happened, AJ. It was like right there.
So if you had the tennis racket right there, it would have been right too good.
I didn't know what to do with it. You know, I
just don't go to him over the head with
I went, no, no, he was watching. And then we processed all the next day. But anyway, we've got a squash racket now. So I wanted to tell you that that's a good tool for people who live in apartments or you can't go out beating on your shed, you know, like this guy does.
Yeah.
Get a tennis racket.
Yeah,
a
tennis racket.
You can use it on a pillow and it's quite effective.
And you can beat the hell out of the pillow without breaking
it. It doesn't break, yeah. So anyway, okay, that's
I'm
it.
I'm pressed. Yeah, here we go. That's good. Just one thing I'd like to say from what Ray was mentioning. And that is that resistance is a big issue. And if you find yourself getting tired, that's a big indication that there's resistance. Right? Tired, boredom, they cover huge emotions. Huge emotions. So oftentimes what we do is we teach ourselves at the soul level how to shut down. And there'll be certain subjects you find really fascinating. I've noticed as an audience, that you all really perk up when we start talking about spirits. I noticed as an audience, when we talk about emotions, you all get quite depressed, right? So what's going on there is that the spirit discussion, which is an external truth discussion, you're attracted to. But the internal truth discussion, you're still feeling resistive to. Does that make sense? As an audience, I mean. Not all people in the audience, but as an audience. So what that means then, is that there is resistance inside of you about going into the emotional thing. So let yourself acknowledge the resistance. Remember, the way an emotion flows is truth will open you emotionally. So I am tired because I want to be tired. So don't say, oh, I mysteriously go tired. You know? No, you're tired because you want to be. You want to be tired because it detunes you emotionally from going into some things emotionally, feeling some things emotionally. One of the things I've noticed emotionally as an audience is this resistance to personal responsibility. So any time I raise issues regarding personal responsibility, so remember our law of compensation discussion that we had a few months ago. Many of you became quite low during that discussion. And that's because there's a personal responsibility involved in the law of compensation that you don't want to hear about. So allow yourself to acknowledge those things, at least acknowledge them. When you start acknowledging them, emotions start to flow. Resistance is often, we often don't use anger, but we often use more manageable aspects of resistance. And one of them is boredom. I'm bored now. Can we get on to another subject? I'm bored with this one. That kind of thing. That's an avoidance, you see. And if I'm also doing things like, oh, this is really tiring, can't we talk about something? Then as soon as we go down that road, can't I do something else? It means that I'm not really tired. Because if I was really tired, what would I be doing?
Sleeping.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you'd be sleeping. And if you're not sleeping right at that moment and you're saying you're tired, it's because you're not interested in that particular subject. You're better off walking out, going home, really, than staying in many cases. Does that make sense? I won't be offended. Karen, you want to? Karen, do you mind if you mention some of your law of attraction stuff that we talked about earlier?
Can I ask some questions
first? Sure, you can ask some questions first.
Hopefully these questions will be short.
It doesn't matter how long they are, by the way. We've got 2 hours.
One hour. Keep myself good on that. One is just when you're saying tiredness is boredom is resistance. Is having trouble sleeping because you want to be tired, or is that a different thing?
So the question is, you're having trouble sleeping.
Yeah. Is that because I want to be tired?
What do you think?
I don't want to be tired.
No, so
I've been tired.
What don't you like about sleeping?
I want to sleep, so I'm not tired.
No, so this is an untruth. The law of attraction is telling you the truth. The law of attraction is you're not sleeping.
Yeah.
So the truth is you don't want to be sleeping. So that's, you see what I'm saying? This law of attraction is I'm not sleeping. So the law of attraction is telling you the truth. I do not want to sleep. now say, that's the truth, I do not want to sleep. You say that. I do not want to sleep. Say it again. You're going to feel this. I do not
want to sleep.
Now ask, why don't I want to sleep?
Why don't I want to sleep?
What's the feeling comes up straight away? Why don't you want to sleep? I can tell you what I'm feeling from you when you ask that question.
I really don't know. As soon as I think about sleep, I think it's wonderful to be asleep because I'm in that, you know, through the mist of sleep space.
But what's happened there is you've skipped over the emotion that's driving you to not sleep. You're still telling yourself the untruth. You're still saying, I do want to sleep. See, can you see how intellectually I can say, I do not want to sleep. But if you feel like you do want to sleep, even though you're not sleeping, then straight away there's a disharmony there. Do you follow me?
Yes.
The disharmony is the truth, the law of attraction is telling me the truth. The truth is I do not want to sleep. You're saying, but I do want to sleep, but I do want to sleep. And I'm saying, sorry, you don't want to sleep. So why don't you want to sleep? That's okay, that's the truth. You don't know? What, if you had a gut feeling, like, what do you think it might be about? Just imagine for a moment, you don't want to sleep, you're laying there, not getting sleep, it's quite annoying, frustrating. But there's something about sleep, like, if you go to sleep, what might happen? She said she's scared of who she will meet in her sleep state. She asked that question. But often these states, see, that's what came into her mind from her soul. So go with that now, all right? Who might you meet in your sleep state?
Well, innocent,
who are the people who have passed that you felt you had dealt with the emotions about, but you know now that you haven't?
My husband and my father.
Okay. And what did they do in their lives when you were younger? Not now, but when you were younger, what kind of treatment did you get from these ones?
From my father, I don't at all remember being harmed by him or anything.
He was an angry man.
He was a very angry man, and I was very frightened of his anger. And I have known for a long time that it's deeply affected a lot of things in my life.
Okay. Now, what about your husband?
He was a very peaceful, loving man who put me on a pedestal. But more lately, when I'm asking myself questions about sexuality, I'm thinking there's things there that he did wrongly that he's not wanting to acknowledge.
Okay. So we've got two issues, both to do with men, both probably related to your sleep state experiences, which cause you to feel like you do not want to sleep. One is a feeling to do with sexual shame and guilt, perhaps, and sexual manipulation. And the other is a feeling of fear, being controlled and manipulated by a man in a fear state. And probably what's happening, because of that law of attraction, in your sleep state, you're attracting these two men to you to deal with those emotions, and you're quite afraid of that, so you don't want to go to sleep. So if you actually start dealing with those emotions in the awake state, you'll find you'll go to sleep quite peacefully.
Thank you.
See how it goes?
Yeah.
Is that the only question?
No.
She's got a list.
There's only the second one.
Go.
Before you were talking about soul and physical body and the spirit body and how we can do things with our spirit body to make us feel better.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess what I want to know is, I've got a friend who is, she's picking out on divine love at the moment, okay?
Yeah, so she's enjoying herself.
She's having a great time, and it's wonderful. And she, like a few months ago, shortly after this started for her, she was saying that she really started feeling terribly emotional after she saw this lady who channels, I'm sure, natural love spirits. And after she saw her, she started having a lot of emotions. And I said, I need to do that. I need to find some way to start my emotions. So maybe I'll see this lady. And I went through a lot of fear and anxiety because this might not be right, and it might be right. And in the end, I just went for it and said, God will look after me if I'm wrong, or he'll tell me soon enough. And so I went to see her, and I said, all I want is for you to help me feel my emotions. This is how I feel. I'll get closer to God, and I want you to help with that. And she said, okay, all right. But she was, she's full of love, and she's scared. And so she did this stuff, and humming stuff and hand stuff, and said, is there something wrong with your bits of my body? And I said, no, but I don't care about that. I just want to feel my emotions. And she said, because all her spirits were telling her stuff about me, and I said, but anyway, so she did this, and then said, wait for 3 days, and absolutely nothing happened. I don't know.
Well, let me explain firstly why something happened for the other lady, your friend. When your friend went along to this medium, what actually happened is this: around a medium or around a psychic, there are literally hundreds and hundreds of spirits all the time. And many of them are constantly wanting to contact humans, and they'll often misrepresent themselves in the process as well, because they have emotions that they need to speak, they need to talk openly and so forth. And so what they do is they surround the medium, and that's the medium's law of attraction. Does that make sense? The law of attraction of the medium is that she's attracting all of these spirits around her. And what happened when your friend went along to this medium is that your friend actually attracted some of these spirits who had sympathetic emotions. And remember in the earlier talk that I just gave, I said the spirits are attracted to you to heighten your own, to make more sensitive or more intense your own experience, to actually help you deal with your emotions. What happened with your friend is she allowed herself to feel that higher intensity of emotion and got into the emotion. But your intention, even though you think your intention is to feel your emotion, at the moment your actual emotional intention is to not experience your emotion, because the law of attraction tells me this. If you're not experiencing your emotion right now, then your law of attraction is, I do not want to experience my emotion. It's quite simple. You can tell yourself anything else you want. You understand? But your law of attraction is telling you the truth. If you are not experiencing your emotion right now, it's because you do not want to. So you are better off saying, I do not want to experience my emotion right now, and then ask the question, why? What am I afraid of? What am I afraid of? And if you can, and you will actually start accessing your blockages. And remember, we had our earlier discussion with that, and I was talking to you about your blockages about the emotion. So the truth is, at the moment, you do not want to experience your emotion, or your emotions are actually blocked by the blockages which are stronger than the desire to feel the emotion. So while you do have a desire that's growing to experience your emotion, you've got these other emotions inside of your soul which we call blockages, which are much more intense and stronger, and you'll need to firstly deal with those.
Which you do with your mind?
No, you need to experience them emotionally. So, one of the emotions we talked about earlier is you feel that God is an angry God. It comes from, remember, your dad being an angry dad. Now, one thing that's happened with Karen's dad is that the dad has become more repentant about his actions during his later life, right? So then she feels like she can't blame him for being angry anymore, even though the feeling is still within her that he was an angry dad. Does that make sense? So that blockage, which is, I'm not allowed to judge my father as angry, that blockage is actually preventing the experience of how that anger felt for you when you were little. And so it's the blockage that needs to be addressed firstly before the emotion can be addressed. But again, the law of attraction is telling you, if you are not right now experiencing the emotion, then when you say to yourself, I really want to feel my emotions, you are telling yourself a lie. Does that make sense? And it's really important to understand that.
Yep. And so I pray to God every waking moment saying, help me soften up the blocks.
and again, I must not be saying the right things.
Well, no. Look at your desire again. Do you really want to feel the blocks? You see, a lot of the blocks are quite intense. And when I say the blocks being intense emotionally, a lot of our blockages are fear-based or terror-based blockages. Does that make sense? Now, terror and fear-based emotions are some of the most difficult emotions to actually allow yourself to experience. Because you go into shaking things and you go into all these different things, and some of you have already experienced this, right? Where you've started going, and what starts to happen in your mind is you're starting to freak out. What's happening to me? You know, you start really, really worrying about your own sanity. You start worrying about what's going on physically. You start thinking you're going to, something's going to happen to you. And so there's so much resistance to even experiencing the fear. And we need to allow ourselves to experience the fear, because the fear is a block to actually experiencing the underlying emotion. Does that make sense? Now, many of us have very deep childhood terror-based fears. Well, you imagine what it's like being a three-year-old child getting yelled and screamed at by this adult, like, that's like three times the size of you. Now, that's pretty intense, isn't it? As an experience. Now, if you place yourself there in your imagination, you will understand why you're afraid. That fear is within most of us, right? And some of you are already now, while I'm talking about it, feeling it. Right? Now, you imagine also, let's say you've been abused either physically or emotionally or sexually. Now, imagine physical abuse. You've been abused physically. How much, you know, desire is there going to be in you to not deal with that? There's going to be a huge amount of fear and terror-based emotions about that. How many of you really want to feel that? You see, to get through it, you're going to need to feel it, right? And allow the experience and pray to God through the experience. It will happen quite rapidly if you pray to God through the experience. But the problem is that we're just so blocked about it because we don't even want to open that part of us up. And the problem is that while I'm in that state where I want to keep that part of me closed, God can't get to that part of me either. And it's my willingness to open that needs to change.
So it's only useful to pray to God when you're feeling very emotional.
I would say that it's not so much being very emotional. What is it? It's only useful to pray to God truth. God doesn't listen to error. So if I'm saying to God, I really want to feel my emotions, when there's an emotion in me saying, no, you don't, what do I need to be praying about? Pray to God about, I really don't want to feel my emotions. Talk to God about that. The truth of what you're feeling, not what you think you should be feeling. See, many of us pray to God about what we think we should be feeling, rather than what we're actually feeling. And what we need to learn to do with God is to always talk to God about what we are actually feeling. So if my law of attraction is telling me the truth, and I'm not feeling my emotion, therefore my law of attraction is telling me I do not want to feel my emotion, so I talk to God about, I do not want to feel my emotion. I am quite angry with you, God, for making me feel my emotion. All of my emotions are negative, and I'm sick to death of having to feel my emotions when they're negative. I only want to feel good emotion. I don't want to feel bad. So say all of these things to God, because that's what you're feeling. So say them. And ironically, when you start saying truth to God, that's when you start feeling the emotions. Yeah. Does that make sense? Is that the only two questions?
Well, I can keep thinking of
them. Give someone else a go.
Thank you.
Thanks, Gary. Who else would like to come up?
AJ, I don't need to come up.
Yeah, you do.
The only thing I wanted to ask you was, how do we differentiate between our soul and our spiritual body when we're trying to resolve things?
All right. Why are you trying to differentiate between your soul and your spirit body when you're trying to resolve things?
Because I'm confused.
So what's the feeling or the emotion you need to feel? What did you just say you were?
Confused.
So what's the feeling or emotion you need to feel?
I need to feel confident.
No, you need to feel confused.
Oh, well, I am confused.
That's great. So start feeling it. So what are you confused about? Tell me what you're confused about.
How to resolve issues that I want to be free of.
That you want to be free of?
Yes.
So do you want to be free of?
Yes.
No.
Yes, I do.
No. Your law of attraction is this. If you are not already free of an emotion, you do not right now want to be free of it. Does everyone understand? Stay with me on this one. You need to stay with me on this one. Does everyone understand what I'm saying? If you're not right now free of the emotion, then the truth is you do not want to be free of it. Yeah. Now, why wouldn't I want to be free of an emotion? Because it might be a painful experience feeling the emotion. What else?
There's a bigger emotional investment in staying still than there is from...
Yes, I might be afraid of change. Might be afraid of change. What else?
Getting mileage out of it.
You might be getting mileage out of it. There might be a good reason for holding on to it. You know, people pander to you while you're holding on to this emotion. So that could be a reason why I'm holding on to the emotion. And I could be choosing to hold on to it for that reason. Any other reasons you can think of why you would choose to hold on to an emotion?
Bad.
I want to feel bad because it's the only thing I've ever felt, mm-hmm. right? I don't know what it's like. I don't know what it's like to feel good, right? Any other reasons? Fear of what's the deeper emotion. There might be a capping emotion, then underneath that might be Pandora's box, right? Nobody wants to go there, you know, you open that one and everything springs out then. How many of you feel like you're afraid once you start this, everything's going to come out and that's a major, major, major problem? Isn't it? That means everything's going to come out at work. You know, if you're going to school as a child, it means school, everything will come out with. You know, there'd be so much judgment. How many of you are afraid of judgment? Yeah? Okay. So there's lots of good reasons why you might not really want to feel the emotion. Now, does that make sense? So when you say to yourself, I really want to feel the emotion, and I'm going to recommend this as a general practice for everyone. When you're saying to yourself you really want to feel the emotion, the question you need to ask yourself is, am I feeling it right now? Because if I am not feeling it right now, and you are feeling it right now, which is great. And if I'm not feeling it right now, what does it mean? It means that I do not want to feel it right now. And this is why you didn't want to come up. Because you didn't want to feel your emotion in front of everyone. And it's great you are. Come up in. Join us. Very brave people coming to the hot seat. We must give everyone a clap who's already come to the hot seat. Ian and I only met 2 weeks ago, by the way.
Last Wednesday night I watched the October DVDs, which are mainly Cornelius telling the story, and I cried quite a bit, and it was when I took the, this another story, when I took the CD out of the CD player, I got a splinter in my finger.
The last splinter from the CD?
Off the CD. Mm-hmm. And next morning I was wondering what this might be about, and I'm not quite sure about it.
Side of the body, his left hand.
Right here, you can see where it is.
Yeah.
I think it was Friday morning, I got to the stage, because I cried when Cornelius looked into the eye, your eyes, and dropped the hammer and put it behind the nose into your hand. And I looked into the mirror on Friday morning and just burst into tears. Mm. Think I'm crying about myself.
You are.
Not looking into your eyes. Come on.
Yeah. Because remember, everything you resonate with is something going on inside of you anyway.
Yeah.
So this is lovely about, this is why it's so lovely when people tell you an experience. If you resonate with it, if you go into that emotion, it's pretty powerful because it's your emotion. Yeah. One of the things that I'd like to mention is the splinter on the left-hand thumb.
Yeah.
And left hand, female issues. Thumb usually talking about, is usually a worthiness issue. So it's to do with unworthiness with women.
Right.
And some of your crying is actually probably to do with that too, if you sort of feel about that. So it was a good law of attraction about it.
Yeah.
Oh, so rather than cursing the manufacturer, you've got to thank them. Is that all the only question?
Yeah.
No worries.
Yeah, I think there was definitely the self-worth and the crying when I looked into the mirror. I had to deal with how I, what I call cyclic self-blame,
yeah,
going round and round.
That's it.
Myself. And I looked in the mirror and I felt that I could love myself.
Awesome.
Feeling. Yeah.
So you had a feeling that you could love yourself.
That I could love myself, and the tears were about my loss, about not loving myself.
Awesome. That's exactly right. Spot on. Is everyone enjoying this?
Yes.
Feel a bit brighter?
Yes.
Yeah, it's great focusing on other people's problems. And that's one thing I'd like to bring up with you later in Lessons of Love, is that quite often other people's issues are so easy to focus on, but our own are really, really difficult. And the key is to have a look at that emotionally, what's going on inside of you emotionally with that, why you find that so much easier. So Jen's going to help you focus on her emotion.
What I want to talk about is really personal to both Graham and I, and it has to do with my whole journey, being an abused person sexually, and in my law of attraction with Graham, we are having troubles in our sex life. I've attracted in Graham a really warm and loving man, but in many senses, it seems like he doesn't desire me. And so, I'm having the trouble, which is why I've decided to come up and talk about it.
So your trouble is that you feel a real deep sadness about not being desired sexually?
I feel Graham's my soulmate.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel deep love for him. And I'm growing in a sense of love for myself in order to heal from what seems like a whole lifetime of sexual misadventure, and that's probably a nice way of putting it. And in my relationship with Graham, I've had the opportunity to grow in ways that I know could not have been achieved any other way. And when I've gone to leave him, God's intervened and given me revelation, divine love, to stay with him, to verify to me, to give me the edification that together is where we belong, but yet...
You don't feel it's fulfilling either?
No.
So what I'd like to do is just to, and perhaps you don't have to stay for this discussion now, because it's going to be quite a long one, but I'm going to do that. It's great. It's firstly great for somebody to talk about their sexuality. That's a really powerful thing. So and it's really great too, because it does bring up a lot of law of attraction issues. So I'd like to raise the law of attraction issues, if I may, between the two of yourself, if you're happy for me to be open about them in a public forum. Are you happy, Graham, to be open about them in a public forum? Well, I'd really like to congratulate the both of you for it as well. You don't have to come up. You can actually go and sit down, because I'll bring up some of those things. And obviously at some point we're going to have a discussion with sexuality, and at some point we'll be having a discussion about soulmates. And that will help answer a lot of these kind of questions. But what's been raised is very, very important questions. Firstly, and I'll talk more personally about your relationship. Firstly, when you attract a relationship, that's your soul attraction. So the other person is attracted into your life and you are attracted into their life because both of you are there to help each other deal with your different emotional conditions. Now, here's the feminine part, if you like, which is yourself, right, Jen? So that's Jen. That's the feminine half of the soul. This is the masculine half of the soul. I've drawn them probably the wrong way that I normally do, but that's Graham. How do you spell your name, Graham? It's So there's the two halves of the soul, if you like. Now, it's God's intention that these two halves of the soul eventually combine back as the one full soul. Right? Now, for that to occur, obviously, any emotional barriers that are between these two halves need to be healed. And this is the beauty of a relationship. Because a relationship can go a long way to actually healing these barriers that prevent the two halves of the soul from joining. You follow me? So the first thing I need to understand when I enter a relationship is that I have attracted this person to heal some soul-based damage. Whether this person is my soulmate or not is immaterial. I have attracted this person to enter to heal soul-based damage. Now, if it happens to be my soulmate that I've attracted, you'll find that there will be an even more intense feeling of the damage between each other. So many times soulmates actually meet, spend a short piece of time together, feel these strong, incredible emotions of barriers between each other, and go into a panic and run away. And this happens quite frequently. Now, they will eventually be drawn back together again. And then often you'll see soulmates drawn back together, party and drawn back together. You know, this yo-yo effect occurring. And the reason why that often does happen is because they're still not realizing the one important thing, and that is the law of attraction is drawing them together to heal something, and when they run away, they're running away from healing it. Right? If they stay together, there's a pretty good chance, and they work, and they both have the object of working through their emotions, there's a pretty good chance they'll heal this problem. So, in regards to your own conditions, Jen has been sexually abused by her dad. So it's a father, it's a male-based abuse. Huh? From Graham's perspective, he has always felt like women control him. And not only women control me, but also women sort of suck me dry, is the feeling you have, isn't it, at times? Like, the feeling is one of... if I have a relationship with a woman, I lose myself. So, I lose myself. Lose myself? Not lose myself. Lose myself. Okay. Now, can you see that sexual abuse, for a start, is going to create lots of needy-based emotions in two separate forms? Firstly, one form is there is going to be an anger-based emotions with men, obviously. If it's happened by a father, there's going to be sexual anger with men. Right? But there's also going to be, because all of us have a natural sexual response, there's also going to be a desire for sex as well. So you've got, on one hand, a desire, a sexual desire, but on another hand, an anger-based sex. So it's an anger-based sexual desire. So often what that means then is we start attracting men who treat us angrily in a sexual way. So we start attracting even maybe violent sexual behaviour with a partner, or we start attracting, you know, sexual behaviour that causes us to trigger this anger. And there's also often other emotions too, is the need for closeness, right? Which was destroyed by the abuse. So in other words, so there is this plethora, if you like, of emotion when we were abused, created towards the gender that abused us. Now, if we've had two genders abuse us, both male and female, mother or father or someone else, then obviously it becomes even more complicated. Now, the two different emotions are being triggered. Now, obviously, Graham then, from a sexual perspective, will love gentle sex. Am I on the right track so far, Graham? So, he loves gentle sex, but as soon as sex becomes, it feels a bit more, shall we say, lustful, then straight away you no longer feel sexual desire. Because when it becomes lustful, you start feeling this control emotion kick in, right? This control emotion of I'm losing myself now, the other person's demanding of me now, and those kind of things. On the other side, Jen, when it comes to feeling your stuff, you know, you'll feel like, and there's also another thing that you desire closeness, okay, going on as well. So there's this feeling inside of you that sexual attention also means I'm close to the person, right? And if they don't desire me, then in the full part, which is also me desiring me sexually, and you are correct, by the way, like in the end, a close relationship will mean that each party will desire each other in a very lustful way, and they'll desire each other. Right? So, and they'll also desire in a very pure way too, each other. And they'll desire the pleasure of each other as well. Now, obviously, when there's different abusive issues happening, this issue, by the way, is just as abusive as this one. And what happens is we start setting up a thing where our desire is modified by the error. So the only way to deal with these issues is to talk about them openly and honestly with each other. I feel this when this happens, I feel this. Right? I feel that. I feel I'm not, in your case, I'm not desired by you. Jen.
We're doing all of that.
Yep.
We've reached the point where we're asking you, because we've gotten to the point where we communicate so fully with each other.
Yep. So Jen's saying she communicates fully with it. They both talk openly with each other. They're so open that they're even open to discuss this issue in front of you. So that shows how open they are, right? So they're very open, but still not getting to the core emotion. So that's the issue. So the core emotions are, the core emotion for Graham, I'm going to lose myself if I get into, like, a lustful sexual act involved with a feeling of lust towards my partner, or I feel their lust. I'm just going to go with that and I'll lose control of myself. So the core emotions for yourself, Graham, are about losing control with the opposite sex, not allowing yourself to be vulnerable for that to occur, because you want to maintain control, and you're only allowing yourself to lose control when the other person has a vulnerability. Right? So it's a matter of going into that emotionally now. So letting yourself feel the grief that's associated with that in your past relationships, but also going way back to the causal emotion, which is related to your mother. And that's the area that you need to work on a lot, which is related to mum. The feeling that she, from us, if you could think of it from an emotion point of view, she was like this over you. If you were just this little child, she's like this thing over you, controlling you constantly from an emotional perspective. So even though she might not have done it, you know, in a physical way, emotionally this is what she was like towards you, and you're pretty sensitive. And so, you know, you felt all of those things. And by the way, sensitivity in the soul is a great thing. So it's a really great thing. So the key for you now is to start experimenting with that. So the way to experiment with that is, and this is the beauty of a relationship, is to have sex of a certain type of nature that actually will trigger that emotion, and then allow yourself to get into that emotion. what you've been doing is avoiding it, which was going to prevent you from getting into the emotion. So, for example, and this is something many women find confronting as a discussion, because many women have some really definite control issues when it comes to sexuality because of being damaged so much by, historically and generationally, being damaged so much by men, that you don't allow yourselves then to get into an open state sexually to deal with that emotion. And so it's very, very important to allow yourself to deal with sexual-based emotions and be open enough to experience things. Now, I'm not saying, you know, get involved in violent sexual acts, for example, just to experience that. What I am saying is get involved in a loving transaction with your partner, right? And if anger comes up, stop and feel the anger. Right? So most of you, so what might happen is that, like, you're in the sex act, sometimes it's feeling pretty good, right? Sometimes. Is it? Sometimes? Right, anyway, so it's feeling pretty good. And then an emotion passes through you of anger. Imagine. Now, you're in this turned on state sexually, you will be very tempted to actually deny that anger. Right, and try to make it go away. Right? But the problem is, as soon as you do that, you are detuning yourself from your sexuality as well. You follow me? You're far better off right at that instant tuning into that anger, stopping the sex action remote, tuning into that anger, and yelling it. Being angry. You've done this, you've done that, you know, let yourself do that. And if both understand that it's actually working through an emotion, it won't affect your partner very much. I know that sounds funny. Now, aside from the fact that he might be a little disappointed about it, but that's a good thing for him too, that's his law of attraction. Now, if both of you allow yourself to do that in that manner, see, a lot of men have emotions of demanding of woman sex, right, which they need to deal with. A lot of women have emotions of being angry about men's demands, which they need to deal with. And the key is, if you're experiencing that during the sex act, just stop the sex act, feel the emotion, then re-begin again. Do you understand? Yeah. Just go again. You can stay all day in bed, you know, and do it. You're allowed to. Anyway, so my suggestion is to do that and allow yourself to trigger that emotion. Now, what will happen when you feel the anger? You might start expressing anger, and all of this really, like, rage come out of you that you didn't even know existed. And you may stay in that, finish up staying in that state for 2 or 3 days, running around, but make sure you don't stay there. Make sure you experience it. So the problem with staying there is you could stay there for 25 years, right, and not have any sex anymore and blame men, and, you know, and you're going to miss out on all this joy, right? So don't do that. Don't stay there. But I'll get to it in a minute. Don't stay there, but let yourself experience the emotion and really express it. So if you're a lady who's got angry in that state, express it, and if you need to express it more, get out the tennis racket, as Ray said, start bashing the pillow, you know, and he'll probably want to go in another room. Another room, right? Just to protect some bits, but that's the way it goes, you know. So let it all be expressed, right? And let yourself experience those emotions, and then come back to it. Then come back to it and go further. And what will happen is, if you allow that, what will happen is layers will come off of you, and you'll get to a point where you can be totally open and vulnerable with the person emotionally and sexually, and you'll have dealt with many of the issues. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay, so now I can... Question?
Craig and I have gotten to the point where I want to be aware, but...
Yeah, can you? Can we say that to everyone? Are we changing tapes in a minute?
Yeah, in that. You've
got 4 minutes.
Graham and I have gotten to the point where, well, I've asked the question, is sex a learned response? Because I've been married twice and I've got children, and I don't think I've ever been in a loving relationship ever before. Mm. And I... just recently, when we were in bed together experimenting, we really didn't know what we needed to do to express to each other. We got to the point of not knowing. And I realized that I have never ever been in a relationship with a real man before, and I've never ever been in a sexual encounter where I wasn't harmed and real love was present. And I love Graham so much because he is real within himself, and I ask the question, can you learn sexual response?
Totally.
Because Graham and I don't know what to do or how to raise the desire and how to express with each other. If you talk about lust or something kinky or something that's profoundly, you know, right field, you know, something
is that's physically not sexual.
Not associated with love.
And you're
then
right
I
that.
Can write your book on it.
Yeah.
Truly.
And she probably will. Part of the issue is you're being bossy, right? And when a person in a relationship is bossy, either male or female, doesn't matter what gender, the other person has a sexual turn off to that.
Oh dear.
So when you're actually bossy and forceful, even if it's not in a sexual way, you're actually detuning him sexually from you. Can you see how that relates to his injury? See, when a person...
The first thing that I need to say is that I accept what you've said, okay? I accept the bossiness. Mm-hmm. If I accept it, then that's the beginning of me finding how to go, finding...
So, see, if you experiment with this, and this is about sexuality, is not really sexuality, by the way. Sexuality is really soulality, if I can call it that. In other words, it's an interaction between two half souls. We can just turn it off. It's an interaction between two half souls, and the interaction between two half souls is going to very much depend. Your physical sexual response, after a while, your physical sexual response is going to be totally dependent upon the emotional interaction between the two halves of you. Right? So you'll get to a point in your own life where you cannot at all respond sexually to a person without there being love there. Now that even applies in the day-to-day interaction. So if a demanding emotion is given from one half of the soul to the other half of the soul, the other half of the soul is going to be turned off sexually from that. Does that make sense? Now, many of you have experienced this, right? Like, many of you know that, and there's a common belief, like, you know, the man treats the woman badly all day and then comes home and wants some sex, and of course, she's going to be really responsive, isn't she? You know, of course not, because... She's not feeling loved all the day, is she? Does that make sense? So it's okay to feel that emotion. This is a good emotion to feel. So that emotion of demanding goes across to Graham, and his emotion gets triggered, of course, which is this one, which is, I don't want to be involved in this transaction. I'm losing myself in this transaction. I'm not... how can I respond sexually in this transaction? And to be honest with you, and once you are connected to your soul, if you're a male... you will go from this to this within a space of about a second as soon as you feel something's unloving. All right? So it's a very powerful tool for you to actually work through the issues in terms of sexual love.
Can I add that often when...
No, you can't get away with this. Sorry. Come on.
Go.
Everyone else is doing it.
It's not necessarily related. Not so much.
He hasn't
been
wrong.
I don't want to turn it on. Is that it?
It doesn't necessarily relate to sexuality.
Yeah.
But an important realization that I had was that often the very fear of being controlled, which a lot of women have, actually creates a controlling situation towards the man. If I'm very afraid of being controlled all the time, in the end I end up controlling the man in order to not feel controlled.
Mm-hmm.
So possibly for Jen and Graham as well, that's happening on both sides, because Jen's experienced being very controlled, she doesn't want that to happen again, and so has Graham.
Yeah.
So that's, I don't know if that makes sense to you.
Does that make sense what Mary's saying?
Yes,
if you have a fear inside of yourself, whatever that fear is, it creates an addiction for the opposite thing. So if you have a fear of being controlled, you will often become controlling. If you have a fear of being hurt, you will often hurt others. These things happen constantly. Yeah, so.
And it may not be a hurt, the control. It's
always emotional, yeah.
Yeah, it might not be that I even feel like I enjoy controlling men, but just by the fact that I'm very resistive to...
Can you give a personal example?
Probably involves you.
Far away. Which lies? There's plenty of them.
Just probably within our relationship, when I first met you, I had a lot of fear and a lot of... concern about being controlled, and so in the end our relationship started to become on my terms. You know, I would see you when I was free, and you would visit me, and I didn't feel I was being controlling, but I had so much concern about being vulnerable and actually giving and those sorts of things that actually ended up being quite controlling to you, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I had a deep fear about losing myself, actually.
Yeah. So my law of attraction was I was willing to be controlled by a woman in order to maintain the relationship. So what I had to do firstly with that is look at my law of attraction, say, all right, well, I'm being controlled here, like I'm being told basically that the relationship is on Mary's terms. And so then I had to work through that emotionally. So I cried about, I got a bit angry about that initially, not with her, but with my baseball bat and thing out the back, and then connected to the sadness of that, you know, of what that's felt like through my life. And then once I released that emotion, I could then sort of speak to Mary about that emotion, and then that allowed her to work through some of the issues she was feeling as well, some of the fears she was feeling about being in my life, and so that helped both of us get closer, obviously. Can you see how the law of attraction sort of worked there too?
Yeah, because I've got fear about being vulnerable and being controlled.
Yeah, yeah. And fear of being
rigid. It's a big one.
You want
to
stand?
No, someone else needs to.
I was just, you look so pretty.
Yeah,
my sexual projections. Sorry about that. This is a good start. I like this start. She's crying already. She's crying already. I love this.
I just hope I can get the words out. My name is Jen. My first husband name was Graham, G-R-A-H-A-M.
So a big law of attraction for you.
This started before that.
Can I tell you my story?
If it doesn't take too long.
Okay, I'll try faster.
Just when there's other people who want to ask me.
Yeah. When I was 16, I met Graham. For the first 18 months, I fought him off. He wanted to have sex. And as a good country girl, I wouldn't have sex. Then one weekend we went camping, and I'd heard a rumour that he said that if I didn't have sex, he would leave me. So I had sex. I felt pregnant. The Saturday of that weekend, as soon as we did it, I knew I was pregnant. I knew I was going to have a boy. 2 days later, his youngest brother, who was camping with us, was killed in a sawmill accident. And I blamed myself so much for that, because as a good country girl, I was told it was a sin to have sex before marriage. That every time someone died, there would be another birth. So I really, really thought I had caused Russell's death, and I went through hell for quite a while. I had my son, who is absolutely beautiful, who I know now is very damaged from the emotions that I was feeling when he was being carried. 3 years later, I had my daughter, which I love. 2 years after that, I was on the pill. I had a cold. I was on antibiotics, and I fell pregnant. And I didn't realize how angry I was at Graham for getting me pregnant until I got pregnant again, against my will, and I had an abortion. Now, when the other ladies a couple of weeks ago said that, I felt nothing. I was worried about that, so I went to a very good friend who has helped me with a lot of counseling, and I said, I'm feeling nothing, and I don't want to feel nothing. I want to get through this. And I still felt nothing. And I thought, wow, I've dealt with this. Isn't this wonderful? Because I remember in the doctor's surgery when he told me I was pregnant, I'm going, God, no, I can't do this. I'm going to go nuts if I have another child. I was 17. I had no teenage life. And here I was with my second child, just about to go to school and have a bit of freedom, and I was pregnant again. So today, when the other lady was talking about not being able to sleep, I used to have really bad sleeping problems from the ages of about 25. To 35, I used to take Serapax every night to try and get to sleep. And when AJ talked about contacting the soul of the child, I wanted so much to say sorry to that child. So I tried it, and I hope that I had given some sort of, what do you call it? I repented. But the sleep thing brought back the memory that that was the 10 years after I had had the abortion, and that's what triggered it. And I thought, I was just so scared to meet this child, because I was actually told once that I had 3 children by a medium, and I denied it. And she said, but there's a child here who says his name is Michael, and he's connected to you.
I would never call my son Michael because my closest cousin's name is Michael. And when AJ talked about the celestial beings who would look after that child, I thought, well, they've called him Michael. So I thought, well, I'll try and connect with him. And since the last fortnight, I've slept like a baby. So I think he's forgiven me. And I was going to just go outside and have a good cry. But because I've always felt a lot of shame, and I've always had all these skeletons in my closet, that I thought it was about time to get rid of the whole lot all in one go.
Just a few things I'd like to say about Jim's experience. When it comes to law of attraction, when it comes to sexuality, you can see what's going on. The person who doesn't feel like, who feels like sex is wrong, will often have an attraction with a person who feels like they've got to have sex with you right now, and often they'll give in, and these kind of things are created often through the law of attraction. So remember, everything that's happened in your life is through the law of attraction. Everything. So everything that's happened through Jen's life is due to the law of attraction operating upon her soul condition when she was much younger, causing these events later so that she could work through these emotions. And to her credit now, she's working through these emotions really rapidly, and so she's changing very, very rapidly as a result of that. If we can try to keep things to the law of attraction, is that right?
I have sleeping problems too.
So you don't want to sleep, in other words?
Obviously,
yeah, okay.
Yes. This morning I was looking at that, and I believe it's because I'm afraid to sleep because I feel like I have to take care of the children.
So you're afraid really about, if you're asleep,
what's going to happen to the children? And as a mother of one, I know that when I became a mother, it's like, I have to be aware, I have to be awake, I have to look after this child. Now I have two grandchildren, and they live in the United States, and I know it's not my business, it's not my life, and yeah, I feel a lot of things, a lot of connection, a love, desire for the best for all, and the way my daughter is choosing to take care of the children, and she's a wonderful mom.
So what's your question?
My question. Okay. It's based around vaccination. I have strong beliefs about vaccination, and that causes me heaps of pain, emotional pain. I've done so much research about it.
So what's your question?
Question.
It's about your daughter and her children.
Yeah, but I have this pain about vaccination, and when I wake up in the night or can't get to sleep, it always comes around the vaccination. I'm worried about the children. I believe vaccination is a very evil thing.
Right.
Okay.
Let's first look at your law of attraction. Firstly, you're not being honest with yourself. Because anything that you're feeling is about your feelings, not about what's happening to someone else.
Okay.
So if you're passionate about vaccination, you're correct in that vaccination can be a very damaging process, right? So, and there's a lot of soul reasons. If you deal with the soul issues, obviously vaccination is not even needed anymore either. And if you get to a point of a one with God, you'll never need any anti-disease thing because you just won't get disease.
Sure.
But that doesn't deal with your fear. There is a fear that you have inside of yourself about vaccination related to your childhood. So what do you reckon about that?
That's why I'm up here.
So what happened? What can you remember about the vaccinations you've had as a child?
When I had vaccinations, which were very few compared to today, I did it because there was nothing that I knew about. There was no negative.
I'm talking about your feelings, not your beliefs. When you were little, when you had somebody poke this needle into your arm, what did you feel?
I didn't like needles.
Okay. Were you afraid of them?
I didn't like to go to the doctor. Mm-hmm. I didn't like any
injection. So if you put out this great big needle and it's just about to shove it in your arm,
yeah.
What's your feeling?
Not good.
Not good?
That's bad. And my mother is
isn't
a nurse. She gave me shots.
Yeah. Isn't it a terror-based emotion?
Yeah. Yes, yes.
So what's actually happening through your law of attraction is there's this terror-based emotion inside of you about being vaccinated when you were a child.
Okay.
And it's about feeling your way through that terror-based emotion, which is going to mean actually allowing yourself to think about those events when your mum was vaccinated for you, and actually breathe diaphragmatically in your tummy and allow yourself to experience the terror that you felt. See, at the time, you were told that you shouldn't feel the terror, that it was all okay, this is normal, there's a lot of other stories, you know, you need this because of the disease you're going to catch, and all these other things you were told.
Yeah.
But the truth is, there's this terror in you about this issue.
Yeah.
And so when you're worried about your grandchildren, it's actually your terror about your own childhood and what happened when you were vaccinated.
Yes. Well, now as an adult, after having done research and stuff, and it's not just research. It's like before I did research, I knew in my heart it was wrong.
Yeah. So, but the problem is, can you see what we do with our addictions? See, what's really driven you to know about vaccination is this terrible fear of vaccination from your childhood, and that terrible fear created a desire in you to actually find out about vaccination, find out whether it's wrong or right. In the end, whether it's wrong or right is immaterial for you emotionally. What the material point is emotional is that you have a fear and a terror in you about vaccination that you need to experience. But all of your desire to seek the truth about vaccination has all been motivated by this terror about vaccination.
And if I address this, it seems like a simple emotion going back to childhood.
It's going
to
be a very simple terror. It's going to be a terrible emotion to experience.
But it seems like a simple thing to look at and feel. Will then that remove the incredible adult terror I feel?
Yes.
If I just hear the word vaccination, I can almost shake.
Yeah, that's the reason why. So it's a childhood terror. Once you release the childhood terror, you, as an adult, you hear the word vaccination, it'll just be the same as any other word like love or...
Thank you.
A few things about that experience. The law of attraction was telling on so many different paths what the real problem was. Do you follow me? You see, what often we do is that we get a law of attraction event, and then what happens is we start intellectualizing through the addiction. And we become addicted to finding out the truth about it, become addicted to doing all these different things about it. And in the end, it's just the feeling of the causal emotion that needs to occur. And all of those addictions will pass, and we'll automatically know the truth in our heart. The truth is, the children who you're vaccinating already know the truth. They are terrified of a vaccination. They already know the truth. It's not good. In their heart, they already know the truth. Now, I know many of you from a medical profession might be saying, oh, but AJ, you know, what you're going to do is create disease by saying all of these things. No, because if you listen to everything I'm saying there's an emotional cause for every single illness and disease on this planet, and when you deal with that emotion, these diseases will not even exist on this planet. So will you need to vaccinate your child? Of course not, because the disease itself will not exist. Right at the moment, within you, you have literally hundreds and hundreds of different diseases. But your body doesn't respond to them because the emotion that creates the trigger to response is not there. All right? So that's a very important factor to bear in mind. And the child already knows this. The child takes one look at this needle and goes into fear. It already knows the truth. So you wouldn't have needed to investigate all those different things to tell you that it was wrong, if you allowed yourself to just feel the emotion of the child. Now, obviously, it's a terror-based emotion as a child. It's very hard to feel. And when it's our own parent inflicting the pain and the terror, we think we must be wrong. Does that make sense? Obviously, if your own parent is inflicting the pain, what must... You know, you're setting up this terrible conundrum, aren't you, within yourself? And then Linda too.
Mark's my name, I'm from Toowoomba. Does the law of attraction equally apply, or the speed in which you can acknowledge it, equally apply to myself where I have been a Christian and have been an agnostic and perhaps now an atheist? And I noticed tonight you've been talking a lot about spirits, you've been talking a lot about God.
And you're here listening.
And I'm here listening.
Yeah.
So it is a little bit difficult for me to not so much accept the principles of it, but I think there's also, it's going to be aiding a lot of people to progress their problems or their concerns or their issues if they do accept the fact that there are angels, that there are spirits, that there is a God. For me, that can't accept that. There's been ex-Jehovah's Witness for 10 years. It's been Seventh-day Adventist that's studied with Brahmi Kumaris. That's been on a, 20 years of spiritual searching, so forth. And now I'm a railing who believe in extraterrestrial life and we come from a superior intelligence.
Yep.
So I guess my question to the point is I'm having a little bit of problems, a lot of problems. Although not a little bit, a lot of problems. As I said, not accepting the fact that the principles of what you're talking about tonight are very relevant and very true. But I think for me to be able to progress my cause at the speed by which some people maybe, I think I'll be on the lower end of the scale of doing that.
See, I don't agree with that. But anyway, let's talk about the issue. Firstly, the law of attraction for you. The law of attraction for you is that you've always been a true seeker.
That's
right. So you have this burning desire in your heart to know truth. And in that process, you've been attracted to many different religious and non-religious forms of truth in order to actually find out truth, external truth, truth external to yourself. And so your strong law of attraction is that you're willing to investigate anything in order to find out whether there's a truth in it or not. So that's the first thing to bear in mind. So rather than being self-condemnatory about where you are in the scale of things, in terms of dealing with things, the truth is you have one great ability, which not many people on this planet have, and that is the ability to keep seeking for truth even when you're disappointed. Right? So that's a really powerful thing. But allow yourself to feel about the law of attraction even further with this. If this particular path has come into your sphere of operation, it means that the soul, your soul at some point, has attracted it. So you're here through attractions, a desire to know truth. My suggestion then is to experiment with that attraction. You don't have to make decisions about it. All you need to do at the beginning is to experiment with it. Experiment with attraction. For instance, you can actually start saying, all right, I did believe in a God at one time, now I'm not so sure, now I probably don't believe in one at all. But let's for a moment revisit this issue of God and let's start having a longing, like using this law of attraction thing with God, and let's experiment with it. Let's experiment. I'll experiment with it with regard to one issue. Let's choose the issue, whatever issue is passionate for you at the time. Issue might be, what is the truth about a certain issue that's passionate for you? So what you do then is try the experiment from an emotional perspective with that particular issue and see what happens, see whether it works, see what it brings you. So allow it to see whether the law of attraction is actually a valid law, that it's actually something, that it's actually a law of the universe. Allow yourself to experiment with it to see it. So if you can keep an open mind to that and keep an open emotional set to that, what will happen is you'll start attracting into your life the truth about those laws. But one factor that is also part of your law of attraction is this feeling that you're always going to be disappointed. Because you've investigated so much truth and you've become disappointed with it. Like, you know, when you're a witness, you become disappointed with that. When you're seven about it, you become disappointed with that. And then there's other things that you've investigated and you've become disappointed because they've never had all the answers for you. Because obviously you're quite sensitive of the soul and can feel soul-based answers, right? So now start trusting that. And start investigating this divine path that I've been teaching. And investigate it with the same criteria you've been investigating these other things. How does it feel inside of you? And let yourself, through your law of attraction, work your way through those issues. And also work your way through the pain that's still there within yourself about having investigated so many different paths and they all turn out disappointing. To let yourself feel that. Does that answer you?
Yeah, it has. Yeah. Thanks, Mike.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, I think Ryan said next. Linda was next. Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm just feeling her emotions.
Perhaps Jesus?
Yeah. Oh.
Just talking about the law of attraction, mine's perfectly as far as probably an injured child. I've been looking for work with children. I was studying teacher aid work, so I got a call on Friday to say that I had some hours at the school. I was like, oh, yay, great, you know, paid work money. And then I was told to do with one particular girl who has emotional injuries and behaviour issues, and so I have to deal with this. I'm put in a situation where I need to experience her behaviour and try to cope with it. And,
so what's your law of attraction question?
I just know that it's just my law of attraction is perfectly saying to me, well, here you go, here's an injured soul. Feel what you need to feel from this, and because it's not happening with my own children, so now, yeah, I'm attracted to this. And, I haven't had a chance to really think about it, but I'm quite fearful.
So you're afraid already?
I'm afraid because you're meant to, you know, do it within a framework, a system, an education system, so you probably,
So with Linda, what's happening a lot is that she's been shown a lot through her law of attraction that she feels quite grieving-based, sad emotions within herself from her childhood. And what's been happening, she's been very resistive to that, haven't you? Been quite angry and quite projecting out and quite resistive to that and getting angry with the children about it and all those kind of things. So now what's been put in her path is another child who she has to work with in a framework where she's not allowed to get angry and upset and actually face the emotions that this child is facing, which is actually going to be very, very close to the emotions that you have.
Yeah, I actually connect with her quite well, and I really adore this little girl.
Just turn it on because we're getting
feedback. Yeah, I really connect with this little girl. I've known her for about a year, and I love her, and I just feel like, wow, you know, I just want to fix you and make it all right.
But the reason why you connect with her is that you have a very much a mirror of her emotions.
I know, and it's just...
And that's the reason why you're not connecting with your own children, is because you don't have a mirror of their emotions. Does that make sense?
Well, I refuse to see what they're showing my own children as my own injuries, but when it's outside of myself, it just feels different. I don't know.
Well, the truth is that your own children's emotions are a reflection of you, but they're not a reflection of your injuries. Whereas this girl has exactly the same injuries that you have as a child, and you feel a deep compassion for that.
Yeah.
And really what it's about is you not wanting to feel the compassion for yourself.
No, but I will be now, because I think...
Well, we'll see whether you will be, because it will be on your choice, won't it?
Yeah, well, it's just so dawned on me, wow, like, you've just attracted this situation, like, what are you going to do with it? Like, yeah. Use this, because it's, yeah, the law, it's just...
It's the law of attraction.
Perfectly in front of me, and I hope to be able to...
Yeah.
don't know, they may only last a week. I don't know at the job. They might just...
The key with law of attraction events, when you know you've attracted an event, stay with it until the emotion is gone. Do you see what I'm saying? Stay with it until the emotion is gone. Billy, you want to...
Yeah. Your words were, I love this child.
Yeah.
I adore this child. Who were you talking about?
Yeah. So Millie's saying... That,
listen to your own.
That your words were, I love this child, I adore this child. Mm-hmm. See, really what you're saying is that you don't love yourself and you don't adore yourself.
Because I love another child and not myself.
Well, it's about that. Yeah. So it's very much linked with those emotions.
Yeah.
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 Even your words, by the way, will tell you lots of things about your law of attraction. What you say is just a very, very powerful thing.
Mm.
And James?
What Karen was saying triggered a lot of stuff.
Right.
And, you know, I've known for a long time that the emotion causes lots of my... And I spent many years practicing in a way where I avoided prescribing any drugs at all, and then in the process of that I created some issues and problems for myself that pushed me back towards general practice, which I've been doing now for another 12 years, spending every day writing prescriptions for drugs that I have no belief in, prescribing vaccinations for kids that I have no belief in, and inflicting unnecessary pain on children that I have no belief in.
The law of attraction event here. So the law of attraction event here for James is he's hearing the long-term results of a vaccination on a person who's now... What age would you be now?
For me?
Yeah, go on.
Yeah. Well, I'm
61. 61. So for what, 50-something years, you've been living in this fear about vaccination, really, haven't you?
Well, my daughter, when I was pregnant, I did lots of research. And I knew, before I did the research, I knew vaccination was horrible. And then I did it, and I was sure. Okay, so I didn't get her vaccinated. She's
yeah.
never been vaccinated. She's now in the system.
Yeah.
And they're doing it.
Yeah. So the issue is, like, from James's point of view, he's a doctor who's been prescribing these things. And can you see how the feeling when it hits you is just like a ton of bricks? Like, wow, what have I actually been prescribing? What kind of damage have I been inflicting? And so there is some law of compensation issues, of course, which you're now experiencing. So the key now that this law of attraction has brought this to you is to allow yourself to feel the emotion. Just allow yourself to feel the law of compensation emotion. Pray to God about repentance. You know, you're obviously in a repentant state, so pray to God about forgiveness. And let yourself also, from now on, choose a different thing. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks. Now, we've only got 10 minutes more, around about. So there'll only probably be time for one or two more, and then I just want to have a short discussion before we can finish. So.
Mine's the law of non-attraction.
Yeah.
I haven't attracted a soulmate.
Okay. So do you want one?
Obviously not.
Okay. Yeah, the truth is you don't want. Now look at... So the law of attraction is, I think I want my soulmate, I'm really, really lonely for a soulmate, I really want the person in my life who's special, and I really want to have a close relationship, and I haven't got one. So are all the things that I've just said real or not? Obviously they're all not real. The truth is, I really don't want a soulmate, I really don't want to have a person close to me in my life, I really want to stay lonely. Now that feels the opposite, doesn't it, to what you think?
At the moment, my heart's just beating and I'm actually in terror.
Yeah,
and I have been.
That's it.
Has been the whole time.
Yeah. Now, your terror is covering the emotion that you're needing to experience. Right? and you're terrified about feeling these emotions. And the truth is that you do not have a desire for your soulmate, you do not have a desire to have a close relationship with someone because you're afraid, you're really terrified of some things. So would you like to say what you're terrified of? Can you feel what you're terrified of?
Well, I've come up with intellectual ideas, but...
Go on, just let them pop out.
That my sincerity will be stomped on.
Okay, so you feel that if you're in a relationship, the other person's going to stomp on you. A lot of your good qualities will be lost. So it's a deep fear. What happened in your childhood to cause that fear?
My childhood wasn't too bad.
That's not true. Well, you have such a deep fear of your sincerity getting stomped on. Somebody in your childhood must have stomped on your sincerity. You follow me? So there was something going on there in your childhood, wasn't there? With regard to a male, stepping on your sincerity. Have you a male or female-based attraction?
Male.
No. So it'd be in regard to a male.
Scared of my dad.
Of course. Yeah, it's a big thing. A lot of us say, I was scared of my dad. As if that's a fairly minor thing. That's an amazingly huge thing.
Yeah.
You imagine as a woman, you're growing up with a male, possibly the only male in your household, and you're terrified of him. That's going to cause some problems in your later sexual life and your later relationships, don't you feel? Definitely. So allow yourself to say, that is a problem. That is a big problem. He stomped on sincerity. He stomped on quite a few things with his anger. You're terrified of him. You're afraid of him. And you're afraid of men as a result. Does that make sense? And this is why you're not attracting your soulmate, because you're afraid of the man. So what you need to start doing is looking really deeply at the emotions about men that you feel, and let yourself feel firstly the terror-based emotions, but also the emotions underneath about men, because they are the emotions that are preventing you from meeting your soulmate. When you deal with those, you will attract your soulmate. See, at the moment, you are actually repelling your soulmate. And you were right in a way, because you were saying, oh, this is a problem of non-attraction. What's the opposite of attraction? You want a hanky for it?
I've been using stems.
And the opposite of non-attraction, the opposite of attraction is repulsion. Yep. And what happens is when our soul is in a state where we're feeling certain emotions based around fear and terror and so forth, we are in a state of repulsion of the opposite sex, not attraction. Right? So we're actually pushing them away. So if your soulmate come around you at the moment, he'd feel like he's being pushed away. Even, it didn't matter what condition he was in, he'd probably feel like he's being pushed away. So the key for you is to allow yourself to deal with the emotion inside of yourself. Why do I want to push away then? There's all these feelings about that inside of you, isn't there? So let yourself write about them, feel about them, connect with them, talk to God about them. Let yourself feel all of those. And when you release all of those, what will happen is your soulmate will be attracted to you no matter what condition he's in. And no matter where he is, he'll be attracted to you too. And you will be in a state where you can receive him rather than feeling like you want to reject him.
Thank you for that. I always love my dad.
The problem is at the moment, the thing that's preventing you from dealing with your male-based emotions is you have this deep love for your dad. The deep love for your dad is actually not necessarily a love for your dad, because there's very much fear involved in it. So what it actually is a deep desire for your dad's attention, for attention from your dad. Right? But it's tinged with all this fear about your dad as well.
What I think it is my dad changed very much in the last years of his life and put me on a path of health and spirituality, but I'm not touching base with what I felt as a child.
As a child.
I'm seeing him as he was as an adult.
Exactly.
That's what you clarified.
That's a big issue for many of you. You'll find that your parents... as you grow up, your parents are obviously changing too. The law of attraction is knocking them into shape as well, right? And so what often happens is the law of attraction gets us into this point where our parents have changed and they're now seemingly good people. We feel they're good people, but we have all of these emotions from our childhood where we're terrified of them. And the problem is that we judge one using the other. And what we need to do is forget that and just go into that child emotion, because it's the child emotion that is defining my life. That's defining my law of attraction. So that's why I need to focus on those emotions. Does that make sense? So you need to stop. You need to stop getting into this condition of thinking he's good now, so I can't feel that. You can still feel that even though he's good now.
I understand. I was
missing
that. Thank you.
Yeah, that's good. All right. Well, let's now thank you for everyone. It's now 5:30, so it's time for me to finish. I think everyone's pretty exhausted. What I really liked about those personal experiences is that all of you are starting to connect emotionally to what's going on. And that's a great thing, and that's really what we're doing here. The law of attraction is such that it's wanting you to feel these emotions. That's what it's there for, to actually access these emotions, to access these fears, to access all of this stuff. And if you allow it to work like God intended it, then it can be God's messenger to you. But if you resist it, God's not talking to you anymore, and you're going to be all on your own, and it's going to feel that way. So let yourself look more powerfully at the law of attraction in your own life. Take complete responsibility for that attraction. Even every single person who's spoken to you this afternoon has been your law of attraction. Somebody here would have been affected by what's being said by different people here, and that will all be based on the law of attraction. So allow yourself now to experience those emotions. It's been great spending a bit of time with you today, and I look forward to those of you who are coming tomorrow. Tomorrow the discussion is about spirit communication, so you'll find that quite interesting. And then in the afternoon, after the discussion, after that, we'll be focusing on a plan that we have to help those of you who want to be mediums to actually start developing that gift, and those of you who want to be healers to be able to start developing that gift. So that's our focus tomorrow. Thanks very much, guys.
Thank you.